Today is the last Sunday of the year 2012. We pray to you, Lord, that the message you have for us this morning make a turning point in our life. Consecrate your message, Lord. Speak through your servant, Lord. Let us give glory to your name. Father, we pray in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Please be seated. We shall find our scripture reading this morning from the book of Matthew, chapter 20. Book of Matthew, chapter 20. And we shall be reading from verse 1 to 16. For the kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire laborers for his vineyard. When he had agreed with the laborers for a denarius for the day, he sent them into his vineyard. And he went out about the third hour and saw others standing idle in the marketplace. And to those he said, you also go into the vineyard, and whatever is right, I will give you. And so they went. Again he went out about the sixth and the ninth hour, and did the same thing. And about the 11th hour, he went out and found others standing around. And he said to them, why have you been standing here idle all day long? They said to him, because no one hired us. He said to them, you go into the vineyard too. When evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to his foreman, call the laborers and pay them their wages, beginning with the last group to the first. When those hired about the 11th hour came, each one received a denarius. When those hired first came, they thought they would receive more, but each of them also received a denarius. When they received it, they grumbled at the landowner, saying, these last men have worked only 1 hour, and you have made them equal to us who have borne the burden and the scorching heat of the day. But he answered and said to one of them, friend, I am doing you no wrong. Did you not agree with me for a denarius? Take what is yours and go. But I wish to give to this last man the same as to you. Is it not lawful for me to do what I wish with what is my own? Or is it your eye envious because I am generous? So the last shall be the first, and the first shall be the last.
Amen.
May God bless his holy word. The theme for this morning is account of my stewardship. Account of my stewardship. When we started the year 2012, we prayed to God collectively and individually that God should help us to achieve this and to achieve that. Individually, some of us did make resolutions or wishes that by the end of the year, God being on my side, I will achieve a certain goal. What we make consciously or unconsciously is like entering into a covenant with God. That Father, if you give me the grace to achieve this or to get this, I will serve thee. God will not give you any gift or elevate you into any exalted position, which you will use to serve Satan or glorify yourself instead of Jehovah God. God expects you to be accountable to him. Hence, he charges you to take dominion over everything that he has created. The Holy Bible is also very concerned about how and what we do with our life. These are some basic questions which we don't often find necessary to ask ourselves. These are, am I accountable to anybody? How I use my life? Am I the owner of my life? While I'm still alive? And do I have the right to do whatever I like with my life and times? Like we have read in our scripture reading about the parable of the kingdom of heaven in Luke 19. What have you done with the talents that God has given to you? And what have you done with the treasures of blessings which you have received from him since the past 12 months? God bestowed upon all of us, irrespective of age, gender, diverse spiritual gifts, talents, and blessings, be it material benefits or spiritual benefits, which we also hold accountable to God as stewards against the day of reckoning. We have to understand one thing, just in case we may be thinking that whatever I have achieved is my luck, or I work hard for it, or I qualify to possess it. It has nothing to do with God, and hence do not owe anybody any explanation or accountability how I enjoy or use whatever I have been able to achieve since I came into this world. Unless we care to say, I meditate on the things which God has created and given to us to bring us to where we are today, it will be difficult to appreciate anything and hence incapable of thanking God or even acknowledging his mercy, just like ingrates. Today we should be asking ourselves, how many of us could do without what we have been taking for granted all these years? We have the eyes to see. We have the legs to walk. We have arms to lift. And we have all the parts of our body complete. We have shelter over our heads. And we are not naked or hungry. Or besides, we are enjoying the fellowship of our Christian brothers and sisters. Are we better than all this, all those that don't have what we have, that we have not yet fully utilized all these benefits to glorify God? As Christian believers, how have we utilized the resources entrusted into your care? Contrary to the belief of some people, we have very limited time to pass through this mortal. To man, what appears to be 100 years is about 1 second in the eyes of our Creator. The Bible, knowing the vanity of man's thoughts, reminds us in Psalm 90 about the travels of man's existence on earth. We only have a very limited time on earth to fulfill God's purpose within this period. Many a times I often heard people say, my life is too short. And despite that, while some strive to achieve as much as possible, others waste their lives away in complete idleness. And some come to church to worship God, but they are just like those in the parable of the sower, where the seeds fell on the road path. And even though they listen to the message, but no sooner they are out of the church, Satan comes and picks the seeds from their hearts, because their minds and hearts are somewhere else in the church. The question is, how many people do really ask themselves that after we have achieved so much in our lifetime, which portion of our achievement do we use to glorify God? It is when we have come to that understanding that everything that we have achieved are directly as a result of God's grace and mercy, which not many people are aware of these facts. They still attribute these successes to their own efforts and ingenuity, and hence lose the hope of receiving more blessings from God. The Holy Bible, being the words of God, had known all the vanities of humanity, and these were revealed to mankind in Psalm 36, 5-10. Thy mercy, O Lord, is in the heavens, and thy faithfulness reached unto the clouds. Thy righteousness is like the great mountain. Thy judgment are a great deep. O Lord, thou preserve man and beast. How excellent is thy loving kindness, O God. Amen. Therefore, the children of men put their trust under the shadow of thy wings. They shall be abundantly satisfied with fatness of thy house. And thou shalt make them drink of the river of thy pleasures. For with thee is the fountain of life. In thy light shall we see light. Oh, continue thy loving kindness unto them that know thee, and thy righteousness to the upright in heart. Today, being the last Sunday of the year 2012, we should now be asking ourselves, what have I done with the talents that God has given to me. You often think of God's gifts, other three easy aspects: our time, our talent, and our material benefits, which some people refer to as treasure. And each of these gifts has been given to us by God to manage during our lifetime and to glorify Him.
Amen.
What have we done with our time? God has given us time within which to live through this Mother Earth and accomplish what He has destined for each of us. The psalmist saw this truth, and in Psalm 90, verse 12, it says, "So teach us to number our days, that we may present to you a heart of wisdom." The Bible made us to understand that our God did put great importance to time, and you cannot serve God in spirit and in truth if you are not time conscious, or you are the type who has no regard for time. In one of our messages, we spoke about this precious gift time 12 months ago. And today we are asking ourselves again, what have we achieved? How have we whiled away the past 12 months of our lifetime? I don't know about you, but for me, every passing day is a grace which should be fully utilized.
Amen.
From my laptop, I could watch the news. I could watch video films. But you will not believe this. Despite the fact that I have to pay some subscriptions monthly, I could still not find time to sit down and watch TV or even any video, because when I'm tired, I feel like taking my eyes off reading. And the only two options left for me is either to lie down and close my eyes, or the next option of watching anything on the screen will also amount to straining my eye. So I just close my eyes and meditate.
Amen.
Today, how do some people use their eyes? The eyes, being the window of the heart,
yes,
can bring you closer to God.
Amen.
As well as causing you to stumble and drift away from God.
Mm-hmm.
Our Lord said in Luke 11:34-36, "The light of the body is the eye. Therefore, when that eye is single, thy whole body also is full of light.
Yes.
But when that eye is evil, thy body is full of darkness.
Mm.
Take heed therefore, that the light which is in thee be not darkness. If thy whole body therefore be full of light, having no part dark, the whole shall be full of light, as when the bright shining of a candle doth give thee light." If we have not been using our eyes to see things that will help us our spiritual development, but rather spending our precious time relishing in sensual videos, or reading Antichrist publications, or admiring the physical features of other women, or women, apart from those still looking for a future partner, since you have to properly look before getting hooked.
Mm-hmm.
Amen.
Amen.
The Lord said, "You are also abusing those eyes, and hence making you to commit adultery."
Amen.
As we also read in Matthew 5:27-29. "You have heard that it was said by them of old time, thou shalt not commit adultery. But I say unto you, that whosoever look on a woman to lust after her had committed adultery with her already in his heart. And if thy right hand, thy right eye offends thee, pluck it out and cast it from thee, for it is profitable for thee that one of thy members should perish, and not that thy whole body should be cast into hell." We have just talked about our eyes. What about our ears? Those two extended organs, which our mothers used to adorn with gold and silver earrings in those old days. But not now, since men of nowadays wear more earrings than the women. Praise God.
Amen.
Yeah, God must have got a good reason for creating those earlobes in the Bible. The great white king Solomon said in Proverbs 2:1-6, "My son, if thou wilt receive my words and hide my commandments with thee, so that thou incline thy ear unto wisdom and apply thy heart to understanding." The wise King Solomon is here admonishing us to closely attend to the word of God, because it is the word of wisdom which is able to make us wise unto salvation. One, we must be convinced that the words of God are the fountain and standard of wisdom and understanding, and that we need not desire to be wiser than they make us. We must incline our ear and apply our hearts to them as to wisdom or understanding itself. Many wise things may be found in human compositions, but divine revelations and true religion built upon it are all wisdom. Two, we must accordingly receive the words of God with all readiness of mind and bid it welcome, even the commandments as well as the promises, without murmuring or disputing. Speak, Lord, for thy servant heareth. Three, we must hide them with us as we do our treasures, which we are afraid of being robbed of. We must not only receive wisdom, but retain wisdom, the word of God, and lodge it in our hearts that it may be always ready to us. Four, we must incline our ear to them. We must lay hold on all opportunities of hearing the word of God and listen to it with attention and seriousness as those that are afraid of letting it slip. And lastly, we must apply our hearts to them. Else inclining the ear to them will stand us in no stead if it does not take root in our heart. And what do we have to say about our mouth and our tongue? The Bible says a lot in Psalm 34:13. For anyone who wants to live long life and have peace, it says, keep thy tongue from evil and thy lips from speaking guile. Among all the parts that God has given to man, the tongue is one of the most precious next to our eyes. As Christians, we are expected to be discreet and kind in the use of our tongue, as our tongue can heal and it can also cause a lot of damage. The Bible says in James 1:26, if any man among you seems to be religious and bridles not his tongue, but deceives his own heart, this man's religion is vain. How can we call ourselves Christians if we cannot control our tongue? We must understand that words have force, and words out of our mouth can never be recalled. The Bible confirmed this in James 3, 2-10. For in many things we offend all. If any man offend not in word, the same is a perfect man, and able also to bridle the whole body. Behold, we put bits in horses' mouth, that they may obey us, and we turn about their whole body. Behold also the sheep, which though they be so great and are driven of fierce winds, yet they are turned about with a very small helm. Whithersoever the governor listed, even so the tongue is a little member, and boasted great things. Behold, how great a matter of little fire kindle. And the tongue is a fire, a word of iniquity. So is the tongue among our members, that it defies the whole body, and sets it on fire, the course of nature, and is set on fire of hell. For every kind of beast, on birds, or serpents, or things in the sea, is tamed, and had been tamed of mankind. But the tongue can no man tame. It is an unruly evil, full of deadly poison. Therewith bless we God, even the Father, and therewith curse we men, which are made after the similitude of God. Out of the same mouth proceeded blessing and cursing. My brethren, these things ought not to be so. What is our resolution for the coming year with regards to the use of our tongue, as we shall be held accountable for the way we use our tongue, since every word we utter is being recorded in the book of life? Amen. My brethren in Christ, whatever we might have done which is not of God in the past 12 months, this is the time to repent and pray to God to give us all clean hearts to be able to face the new year with clear conscience. The Lord does not delight in death of sinners, but that sinners should come to repentance. We serve a merciful and even ever-forgiving God. True believers take the Lord for the portion of their inheritance, and nothing less will satisfy them. The psalmist prayed with his whole heart, knowing how to value the blessings he prayed for. He desired the mercy promised, and depended on the promise for it. He turned from bypaths and returned to God's testimonies. He delayed not. It then becomes imperative for sinners to hasten to escape, and the believer will be equally in haste to glorify God. No care, no grief, no crisis, no strife, and no worldly commitment should take away God's word out of our minds or hinder the comfort it bestows. There is no situation on earth in which a believer has no cause to be thankful. Let us feel ashamed that others here in America, especially the Spanish-speaking fellow Christians, are more willing to keep virgil in order to spend more time praising and worshiping God than we have ever been doing in the past 12 months in this church. We started the night vigil with all enthusiasm, but we were forced to discontinue for lack of interest of our members to serve God. Even the Friday's prayer service, which had been in existence since the church started, only a handful of devoted members have consistently been coming to worship God. Some members have been in this church for the past 4 years, and yet have never set foot in the church Bible study on Wednesday or the prayer service on Friday, as if we don't really need God. We should be more earnest in prayer, that our hearts may be filled with His mercy, grace, and peace. And these are the considerations for each of us this morning, to search our hearts and find out where we have to work out or normalize our relationship with God in the coming new year.
Amen.
As believer Christians, once you have decided to follow our Christ Jesus, you don't go back. As our Lord said in Luke 9:62, no one, after putting his hand on the plow and looking back, is fit for the kingdom of God. What have we done with our talent? We have this word mentioned very often by various classes of people, and often credited to both young and old, irrespective of the class or creed. Talents are hence divine gifts, which are bestowed upon us, which we develop as special skills in achieving certain feats. Talents or skills in singing, in gymnastics, in dancing, in composing music, or even in evangelism, in preaching, in teaching, in our various fields of profession. How then have we in the past 12 months used these gifts or skills to serve and honor God? I wonder how many people have ever bothered to think from where they have acquired these talents. Some believe it is as a result of their practice or inheritance factor, or they are just born genius. The Bible explains to us in 1 Corinthians 12, 4-7, now there are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit, and there are differences of administration, but the same Lord, and there are diversities of operations, but it is the same God which works all in all. But the manifestation of the Spirit is given to everyone to profit with all.
Amen.
When you receive Christ, you gain the right to be called a child of God.
Yes.
As a child of God, you then owe it a duty or responsibility to God to make available your talents to meet God's families and needs. God has equipped you by His Spirit to minister in a way as unique as your fingerprint. In God's family, everyone is considered gifted, regardless of your personality, your IQ, or how high or how low your rank in the society. You have your spiritual gift. The body of Christ needs you, just as God designed. What are the benefits we derive from proper use of our talents? Our God and Savior likened the gift of talents to the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven. As the Holy Bible reveals to us in Matthew 25:14-30, for the kingdom of heaven is as a man traveling to a far country, who called his own servants and delivered unto them his goods. And unto one he gave 5 talents, and to 1, 2, and to another 1, and to every man according to his own several ability. And straight away, he took to his joy. Verses 29-30. When he called them, as we've already been told, the one he gave 1 talent went to go and bury it. And the master said, For unto everyone that hath shall be given, and he shall have abundance. But from him that hath not shall be taken away even that which he hath, and cast ye unprofitable servant into outer darkness. There shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth. What have you done? And what are you doing with the gifts that the Lord has given to you? God has given each one of us different skills and talents. But how are you using your own? What proportion of your time are you using to meet demands of the needs of the house of God? The church. The church is the body of Christ, which is composed of many parts or arms of administration, which basically are the priesthood, the deaconate, the usher, choir, praise and worship, teachers, welfare officers, volunteer stewards who help the church in all her activities. 12 months have passed in our lifetime, during which some of us have denied God of the use of our talents, and despite our refusal to honor God, he is still gracious on us, and still giving us another year within which to reestablish our relationship with him. It is now up to you to listen to the voice of God, which is the word of wisdom, or reject wisdom and pay for the consequences. Our treasure. And this is the joy of partnering with God. When we have or store up treasures, what do we store? We store wealth, riches, and worldliness. How then have we, in the past 12 months, used our treasure to glorify God? The Bible says in Matthew 13:44, again, the kingdom of heaven is like unto treasure hid in the field. Then the which when a man had found, he hid it, and for joy therefore go and sell all that he had and buy that field. A lot has been said concerning how we can use our riches to glorify God, so that God can increase us bountifully. But unfortunately, most of us are still clinging to our poverty mentality due to lack of faith and trust in the Lord. We doubt God because we just refuse to know him. And hence, most of us are still suffering. We are lucky to be in a church where there is presence of God, as has been confirmed by our testimonies on several occasions, both during our church services and prayer services. We have often got ourselves confused about the concept of giving towards the development of the church. When we perceive the church as a physical entity, which consists of four walls, where people of like minds gather to worship, we miss one of the compulsory duties, not even obligations demanded from us as followers of Jesus Christ, because we always get it stuck in our hearts that we are parting with our money to maintain the founders of the church. The church was founded by Jesus Christ.
Amen.
As we read in Matthew, when our Lord asked his disciples, whom did the people think that he is? The Son of Man was? And they said, some say that thou art John the Baptist, some Elias, another Jeremiah, or one of the prophets. And he asked the disciples, whom do they think he is? And it was Peter who answered it in Matthew 16:16-19. And Simon Peter answered and said, thou art Christ, the Son of the living God.
Amen.
And Jesus answered and said unto him, blessed art thou, Simon Peter.